Kitchen. Welcome to the first database lecture series sponsored by Microsoft this year. So today we have Emmanuel Trummer from Cornell. And Emmanuel has done a lot of interesting work on query optimization and including quantum computing as well. So, and today he's going to tell us about query optimization for data analysis. Please take it away.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation. Yes, so in this talk, I'm going to give an overview of my recent work, in particular in query optimization, which is often motivated by the context of large-scale data analysis. As you are certainly aware nowadays, we need large-scale data analysis in business and in industry and in almost all scientific disciplines. But in order to do data analysis, first of all, we need a language in which we can describe to the computer what kind of analysis we want to perform. And one of the most popular languages for the moment, that is the SQL language, a structured query language. And one of the properties that make it so popular is certainly that it is a declarative language, meaning that users describe the data they want to generate, but they don't have to describe how to generate the data. And in order to enable such declarative interfaces, we have, however, to solve the query optimization problem. I'm going to give you a more concrete example later, but on a high level, query optimization is about translating one declarative query describing data to generate into an executable query plan describing how to generate the data. And for a given query, we have typically many choices related to the order of operations or to the operator implementations, and all those choices can lead to execution plans with widely different execution times. So the goal in classical query optimization is to find a plan with optimal execution time. Query optimization is an NP-hard optimization problem. It's even NP-hard to find approximately optimal solutions. But still, we have to solve it mostly at runtime, because for a given query, the cost of an average query plan is typically by many orders of magnitude higher than the execution cost of an optimal query plan. So it's a very difficult problem, but still we want to solve it. And this is why it has attracted a lot of attention in the database research community over the past decades. I would claim that perhaps query optimization is one of the optimization problems that most work has been published on in the database community. And still, on our main conferences, we typically have multiple tracks about query optimization. Companies invest actually a lot of money in order to build very complex query optimizers. So a lot of work has been done about query optimization. However, most of that work refers to slight variations of the original problem model for query optimization, which has been introduced in the year 79. And that model was, of course, motivated by the context of query optimization at that time, which is in particular characterized by the execution engine. And from today's perspective, we can say execution engines in 79 were relatively simple. So we had few choices when it comes to query optimization. The starting point for my recently submitted dissertation was to say that if the whole context of query optimization changes, then the query optimization problem actually changes as well. And if we do large-scale data analysis nowadays, then we do have indeed much more choices when it comes to data processing than in 79. We can, for instance, choose to use cloud computing in order to scale out computation, or we can use crowdsourcing in order to scale out human computation, or we can use approximate processing in order to trade execution time for precise precision. And this has an impact on the query optimization problem, because first of all, I have many more tuning knobs, many more parameters that I can tune. For instance, if I use cloud computing, then I can decide how many and what type of resources to rent from the cloud provider. Or if I use approximate processing, then I can, for instance, choose the size of the samples that I work with. So I have additional parameters, but perhaps even more fundamentally, on a high level, many of those data processing options and others, they allow you to trade between different execution cost metrics. For instance, cloud computing allows you to train between execution time and monetary execution fees, and approximate processing allows you to trade between execution time and result precision. And this means that we have to compare alternative query plans not only based on the execution time, but based on multiple conflicting cost metrics. And this makes query optimization a multi-objective optimization problem. And finally, since we are comparing now query plans according to conflicting cost metrics, there is no such thing as an optimal plan anymore. Since if you are, for instance, in a cloud scenario, some users might care more about minimizing execution fees, but other users care more about minimizing execution time. So the optimal compromise between multiple conflicting cost metrics actually depends on user preferences. So we need to integrate user preferences into the optimization process. Altogether, we can say that query optimization actually becomes a harder problem in the context of large case data analysis, since we have more tuning parameters and more cost metrics. And now I'm going to make things a little bit more concrete by giving you an example for query optimization in the context of large scale data analysis. And that example is taken from my own experiences during a stay at Google Mountain View. And during that stay, I was working on a project about opinion mining. And in the context of that project, I also had to tune the execution of the query that you see in a simplified version on top. I'm not going to go into detail concerning the semantics of that query, but on a high level, I had extracted opinions on entities from the web, and I wanted to combine those opinions with additional information on those entities and with statistical models that would allow me to reliably interpret those collected opinions. So it came down in the end to having to combine several very large data sets, to join several large data sets. And this query was typically executed on a large cluster with thousands of nodes, and execution could take a couple of hours. As you are probably aware, join operations are binary operations. So in order to answer the example query, we could, for instance, start by joining the opinion set with the entity properties and join the result of that with the entity types and the result of that with the entities, and finally the result of that with the statistical models. If I would, however, estimate execution time for that plan, it could be something like a day, so this is pretty bad. The reason is that I have started joining with the largest data set with the opinions, and here you see that the icon sizes, they represent data set sizes. And because I started with the largest one, all intermediate results that will be generated during the execution of that plan, they will be fairly large and therefore take a long time to process. So perhaps it is smart if I start joining with one of the smaller data sets. And in this simple example, this actually works well and reduces execution time to around 4 hours. Now, this plan and the previous plan, they belong to the class of so-called left deep query plans, since the right input of each join operation is always a single table, and the left input is always the result of all previous joins.
Are you going to tell us the query graph, so which table joins with what table?
You mean like between which tables I have predicates? Well, I mean, in this simple example, I won't use that. You could reduce that to reduce the search space size, but of course, in principle, you could also join two tables that actually don't have predicates between them, right? So this plan and the previous plan, they belong to the class of so-called left deep query plans. We don't have to do it that way. We can also construct a plan like this one here with an estimated execution time of 3 hours. And as it is not a left deep query plan, we say that it belongs to the class of bushy query plans. And those terms will become important a little bit later. So far, I have assumed that I processed the entire input data set. I don't necessarily have to do that in all cases. For instance, I could select a sample of 10% of the opinion data set. And if I do that, then I process less data, so execution is faster and reduces to around 1 hour. However, now I'm not getting a complete result anymore. So this means I probably want to compare alternative query plans not only based on the execution time, but also based on their result completeness. And in this simplified example, I assume that result completeness is proportional to the input completeness. Now, the decision which data sample sizes I use is not independent from the join order, because now I have actually changed the sizes of the input data sets, so the current join order might not be optimal anymore. And by changing it like that, I can indeed reduce execution time to around 30 minutes. Yet another relevant cost metric in this context is the amount of resources that I consume in order to answer the query, measured, for instance, by the number of compute hours on the cluster. And in the current configuration, let's say that would consume around 500 compute hours on the cluster. Now I have, however, significantly reduced the size of the data set that I'm processing compared to the beginning. So perhaps the current cluster size is over proportional. And by reducing the cluster size here, I see that indeed I can significantly reduce the consumed resources while execution time only degrades slightly. So probably this plan realizes a better cost trade-off between different metrics. In summary, I had decisions related to join order, related to provisioning of the execution platform, and related to sample sizes. And those decisions would be interleaved, so I couldn't take them independently. And I would compare the resulting plans according to their execution time, but also according to their resource consumption and result completeness. And this scenario already corresponds to a significant extension of classical query optimization, which is mostly about join order and execution time. And I had to do those decisions by hand while I was at Google, and I did them, I made them in a trial and error fashion, and often it actually took more time than I would have liked it to. So it would have been good to have a query optimizer tool which takes the query as input, and as output, it generates a visualization of the different cost trade-offs that I can obtain for the query. Or thinking about it, I'm not interested in all possible cost trade-offs. I'm mostly interested in the so-called Pareto optimal cost trade-offs, also called the Pareto frontier. And a cost trade-off is Pareto optimal if no alternative cost trade-off is better according to all cost metrics. So having those optimal cost trade-offs, that would have been very helpful in this scenario. The problem is the optimization methods that existed at the start of my dissertation and which could have been applied to this scenario, they would take hours to optimize only a single query. So they're definitely not applicable in practice. And in my dissertation, I have developed various approaches that make query optimization in those extended scenarios practical, but also significantly speed up traditional query optimization and extend the problem sizes that we can consider. Those approaches can be categorized into three high-level ideas. The first high-level idea is to make optimization practical by moving it before runtime. Then it might still take a long time, but it happens before runtime, so we don't care so much about it anymore. Doing that is possible if we know that the queries we receive at runtime correspond to query templates that we know in advance, because then we can generate all potentially Pareto-optimal plans in a pre-processing step. Another high-level idea to speed up optimization is to relax optimality guarantees. And I have, for instance, proposed approximation schemes that generate guaranteed near-optimal query plans in seconds, where exhaustive optimization would take hours. And they are applicable to scenarios such as the one that I introduced before. I've also worked out incremental optimization algorithms which divide optimization into many small incremental steps and always give you bounds on how far you are from the optimum at most. Finally, I have also proposed randomized algorithms which do not give you formal guarantees on how far the produced solution is from the optimum, but they work very well in average, and they can treat queries with hundreds of joins considering multiple conflicting cost metrics. Yet another high-level idea to speed up optimization is to leverage novel software and hardware platforms for optimization. I have, for instance, recently shown how we can reduce query optimization to integer programming, which allows us to apply corresponding software solvers. And doing that often allows us to treat significantly larger queries than with traditional query optimization algorithms. Another possibility is to speed up query optimization by parallelizing it on large shared nothing clusters. Because if we do large K data analysis, then we would use those clusters anyway, so why shouldn't we use them for optimization too? And finally, most recently, I have collaborated with NASA in order to show how we can apply a limited form of quantum computing in order to solve certain query optimization variants as well. So you can find more details in the corresponding papers that have mostly appeared on VLDB and SIGMOD in the past 3 years and that have been appreciated in the community. There are certain republications. In the following, unfortunately, I won't have enough time to discuss all of them in more detail, so I just picked the two most recent additions to this graphic, which I have just presented on VLDB in India this year. And the first thing that I'm going to discuss is how we can parallelize query optimization over large shared nothing clusters. Now, more precisely, I'm going to show you how to parallelize the classical dynamic programming scheme in query optimization. And I'm going to give you a little reminder of how that dynamic programming scheme works. In general, dynamic programming solves a problem by decomposing it into subproblems. And in the context of query optimization, a subproblem is a subquery. Here I'm using, for the examples, a highly simplified model where I characterize a query simply as a set of tables that need to be joined. Here in this example, I want to join tables R, S, and T. So subqueries simply correspond to subsets of those tables. And here you see all possible subqueries and the classical dynamic programming algorithm, which is still used in current optimizers. It starts by treating the smallest subqueries, which only contain one table. And for those subqueries, it generates all alternative access paths, and it compares them according to their estimated execution time, and then it discards suboptimal plans and only keeps an optimal plan for each of the subqueries. Now, we use those optimal plans for the subqueries in order to generate plans for the larger subqueries by combining them. And again, we compare them according to the estimated execution cost and only keep the optimum for each of the subqueries. We repeat that until finally we have one optimal plan for the entire query. And this is the algorithm for traditional query optimization. Now let us assume that we are, as before, in a cloud computing scenario where users care not only about execution time, but also about monetary execution fees. Yes?
In this example, wouldn't you have to worry about things such as interesting orders?
I would, definitely. I was thinking about whether should I say that I simplified it or not, but you actually spotted it. Yes, here I simplified by assuming that we don't have interesting orders. If you have interesting orders, then you would basically keep, like, you could keep one optimal plan for each of those interesting orders. True. Now I'm coming to another reason why we might want to keep several optimal plans for each of the subqueries. If you're in a cloud computing scenario and care about execution fees in addition to execution time, then we can still use the same dynamic programming scheme, just that this time we keep all Pareto optimal plans for each of the subqueries. Or let's say that we have only one cost metric, but execution cost depends on an unknown parameter at optimization time, then I can still use the same high-level dynamic programming scheme, just that this time I keep a cost function which depends on the unknown parameter for each of those subqueries. So in summary, I wanted to show you that for many different query optimization variants, you can actually use exactly the same high-level dynamic programming scheme. And this means that if we can parallelize that dynamic programming scheme, we immediately obtain parallel algorithms for most query optimization variants that have been proposed in the past 3 decades. The reason why this has not happened yet is perhaps that query optimization had a reputation of being difficult to parallelize. At least that was mentioned in several recent publications on SIGMOD and VLDB about that topic. And in the following, I'm going to give you a little intuition for why it seems difficult to parallelize. As you see here, I'm drawing all subqueries that you would consider for an example query joining 5 tables. And now I'm drawing dependencies between them if you need the result of one in order to generate plans for another subquery. And already you see intuitively those dependencies are quite dense. And this intuition can be formalized by saying that the classical dynamic programming scheme of query optimization belongs to the class of so-called non-zero polyadic dynamic programming schemes, which generally have the reputation of being difficult to parallelize. This is perhaps why prior attempts at parallelizing query optimization have focused on the case of shared memory architectures, where all optimizer threads share the same memory. And on a high level, those approaches work as follows. There's a master thread which obtains a query as input, and then the master assigns specific subqueries to specific workers and gives them the task to calculate optimal plans for their assigned subqueries. And due to all those dependencies that you have seen on the previous slides, those workers have to heavily exchange intermediate results during optimization, but that is not so much of a problem since they share the same memory and communication is relatively efficient. Now, this has been benchmarked for up to 4 or maximum 8 parallel optimizer threads. The question is, can we use the same approach in order to exploit massive degrees of parallelism, hundreds or even thousands of nodes? And the problem is that, first of all, if we have that kind of parallelism, then we typically have a shared nothing architecture, so we have to assume that different optimizer threads run on different machines. And now the traditional approach actually becomes problematic, since first of all, the number of subqueries grows exponentially in the input query size as measured by the number of tables. And this means that the master node has exponential complexity, so it will eventually become the bottleneck. And also the amount of network traffic is exponential in the input query size, since those workers have to exchange so many intermediate results. And so intuitively, we'd already guess that this parallelization method is not suitable for exploiting massive degrees of parallelism. Yes?
But just to clarify, so now you're talking about actually query execution, right? Not
no.
optimization.
I'm talking about optimization. Okay. I'm talking about query optimization.
Okay.
Yes?
How typical is it that queries actually have that many tables?
That
not
many.
Not just the star schema, where it's pretty obvious how to optimize it.
Well, I mean, in a star schema, if you say that it is obvious how to optimize in a star schema, I'm not exactly sure. So, I mean, you think it's obvious to optimize within a star schema? So, I mean, in general, I mean, what you can always do is to try to exploit the structure of the join graph in order to reduce the number of joins that you need to consider, which is a heuristic that sometimes gives you the optimal result, but it's definitely not guaranteed to do so. With a star schema, even if you apply that heuristic, then I think you still have to consider an exponential number of subqueries, actually. And so in terms of typical query sizes, for instance, TPCH would only have up to 8 queries. But if you consider enough tuning parameters, then actual optimization already with that many tables becomes very difficult and with prior methods not feasible in practice. TPCDS has up to, I think, around 20 tables. And actually, on those conferences, I often hear from industry about queries that have even hundreds of joins or that you would need pages in order to print them out. So there's also very large queries in industry. So, but even for the small queries, optimization can already take a long time. Like one of the possible reasons is that you have multiple cost metrics, but also if you consider, for instance, parameters, then you can easily take hours in order to optimize already those standardized queries. Yes?
Has there ever been work on saying, I already have this huge, massively parallel system, like screw optimization, let's just run it and assume it, like in the sense of how, without optimization or without
right. How does that perform?
How long, yeah.
All right, okay. There has actually been a recent paper on VLDB that studies precisely that question, among others. And they basically come to the conclusion that the distance between the cost of an average query plan and the optimal query plan, it's often orders of magnitude, and therefore optimization is definitely helpful. They even compare different optimization methods, some of them randomized and some of them exhaustive. And even they claim that exhaustive optimization makes sense.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and that is actually not surprising, but I mean, it was worth looking at that in particular, since cost models are often inaccurate in practice.
Yeah, well, so it's been so long optimizing and the query ends up taking, you know.
Yes, I mean, definitely, I totally agree that you don't want to spend that much time in optimization. There might be scenarios where you actually do want to do that if you do it as a pre-processing step, then because then you basically avoid any optimization at runtime. But if you do optimization at runtime, then obviously spending hours of optimization time, that is not practical. But the approaches that I have developed during my dissertation, they basically make it practical and reduce it, for instance, to a couple of seconds. Yes?
I was curious what happens in each optimization task that is given to a worker. I mean, of course, on one extreme, we have a simple cost model formula. The formula is instantiated with times from its child tasks, and you can calculate that, you know, within a few cycles. On the other hand, you can determine what the estimate execution time is by actually executing it, which wouldn't be too helpful. So what happens inside these optimization tasks?
In those optimization tasks, for the moment, all that happens is that the workers generate alternative query plans for certain subqueries, and then they compare their estimated execution time, so they don't execute it, they use analytical cost models, and decide which plans to keep and which ones to prune out.
Okay, so it's one formula per plan alternative.
So usually you would assume that you can calculate the cost of operations in that plan, and there's like aggregation formulas that allow you to estimate the cost of the entire plan if you have the cost of those single operations. Cost estimation is also a very complex topic, but let's say, I mean, it's in a way orthogonal to the optimization algorithm that you use. So you could use the same approach with many different cost models, right? So this parallelization method is not in any way specific to one specific cost model, for instance.
Maybe we should let Emmanuel continue, because I think you're going to show us some critical details that will make
work. Okay, all right, let's, so if it is not clear, then let's maybe discuss about it directly after the slide. All right. So this is the prior method for parallelizing query optimization, and intuitively, it doesn't seem to work well. In order to verify that intuition, I have implemented it on Spark, and I have tested scalability on a large cluster with over 100 nodes, and on the x-axis, I'm increasing the degree of parallelism by, you see, optimization time on the y-axis, and as you see, exactly the opposite happens of what you want to happen, because optimization time actually increases once I increase the degree of parallelism. Because the more work I have, the more they have to communicate over the network. So this approach is definitely unsuitable to exploit massive degrees of parallelism. If you want to do that, then we have to do it in a very different way. And on a high level, the prior method for parallelizing query optimization decomposes the query optimization problem in a very fine-grained manner at the granularity of specific subqueries. So I try to do the opposite of that and decompose the problem in the most coarse-grained manner that is possible. In my approach, the master obtains a query as input, then it sends only that query together with an integer number to each of those workers. And this integer number encodes a partition of the plan space, such that each worker searches for optimal plans only within its plan space partition, and then each worker returns the optimal plan to the master, who just compares the results from each worker in order to determine the globally optimal plan. And there is no communication whatsoever between the different workers. Now, intuitively, this approach seems suitable to exploit shared nothing architectures, because we have polynomial complexity on the master node, and there's only a polynomial amount of communication over the network. But the crucial question is, of course, and perhaps that's yours, not sure, is how we can actually decompose the plan space into equal-sized partitions such that different workers don't need to exchange intermediate results despite of all those dependencies. Was that?
That was not my question.
All right, I see. What was the question, please?
So wouldn't like some sort of hybrid approach be interesting, where you partition the space, you assign to a set of shared memory systems, and then do the optimization for that partition? there.
You could also con sure. So are you talking about a multi-round approach or about?
So you partition your optimization space just like it looks like you're doing
right.
rather than assigning to one worker, you could assign to some small handful of workers that are in a shared memory environment and then just optimize.
That is true. Yes, definitely. You could use on a high level this approach to assign different subproblems within a shared nothing architecture, and within each single node, which might have multiple cores and so on, you could use. For instance, the traditional approach in order to parallelize that.
But you're strictly shared nothing here.
So this one is strictly a shared nothing architecture, yes, right. But you could use multiple levels of parallelization indeed.
Are you going to show us more details? Or
of course.
Okay.
Yes, so and those details concern in particular how I can actually decompose the plan space into those different partitions. And first of all, we're going to focus on the case of left-deep query plans. And as a little reminder, left-deep query plans is characterized by the fact that each join operation, the right operand, is only a single table. And under this restriction, we can actually characterize a query plan as a join order between tables. Now, first, naive way of decomposing the problem would be to fix for each worker the first table in that join order. And the example plan that you see here would therefore be in the second partition from the left, since we start joining with table S. Now assume that we run on each of the workers the dynamic programming scheme that we have seen before. So time complexity on the workers will somewhat be proportional to the number of subqueries that they consider. So now let us reason about which subqueries, for instance, the worker that is treating the second partition from the left, which subqueries the worker actually has to consider. Here you see all possible subqueries, and the worker only has to consider those subqueries that correspond to intermediate results which could occur during the execution of a plan in its partition. And on top in red, I am now drawing the intermediate results that get generated during the execution of the example plan. And you might notice that table S is contained in each of them. And that is actually not a coincidence, since if we start joining with table S, then we will only have intermediate results that contain table S. And therefore, the worker treating that partition does not need to consider any subqueries that do not contain table S. And asymptotically, it means that we get rid of half of the subqueries, but we also need a degree of parallelism that is proportional to the number of tables in the input query.
Question.
Yes.
So here you have two options. Either independent workers will consider the same subplans separately and will repeat the work.
Right.
Or you share information between the subplans between the workers.
Right.
Which ones do you do?
Now, in this simple approach, we wouldn't have any overlap in terms of the plans, but we might have overlap in terms of the subqueries. This is the naive approach. I'm about to present the one that I'm actually using. But for that approach, you have a little bit of redundancy that you need to pay in order to make sure that you don't have to share intermediate results between workers.
You prefer to not have any communication, but instead have more work done there.
That is true. At least we can show that the amount of redundancy that we are getting is minimal within a space of the decomposition method. I'm going to talk about that later. But we will also show that this parallelization method actually works very well in a shared nothing architecture, as opposed to the one that I have just shown before. Right. So on a high level, this means we have to sacrifice a lot of parallelism in order to get a moderate reduction in terms of execution time. Let us see how we can do better than that. We can work with a different type of constraints. We can decompose the plan space based on the relative ordering between a pair of tables. So I can, for instance, say that I decompose the plan space based on whether table R appears before table S in the join order, or whether it's the other way around. And in this case, in the case of the example plan, I have table S directly before table R, and therefore it would be in the right plan space partition. So now let us reason again about which subqueries we can eliminate based on that constraint. And if I have the constraint that table S comes before table R, it means I can never have table R without table S within the same intermediate results. And therefore, I can eliminate all subqueries containing table R, but not table S, which asymptotically eliminates a quarter of all subqueries. And now I can even recursively continue the decomposition of the plan space if I select a new pair of tables, like tables T and U, and I decompose the plan space based on whether table T appears before table U or whether it's the other way around. And in case of the example plan, table U appears first, so it would be in the rightmost partition. And now, again, we can say if we treat the rightmost partition and have table U before table T, we cannot have any subqueries containing T but not U, and therefore we can get rid of all corresponding subqueries. So each time that we double the degree of parallelism, we will reduce time asymptotically by a factor of 3/4, which is already much better than before, but for the moment we are still limited to left deep query plans. So now let us see how we can treat the general case of Bushy query plans. And that seems actually at first challenging, since a Bushy query plan can be an arbitrary binary tree, and this means in particular that we cannot characterize a plan by an order between tables anymore. And the constraints from before refers to an order between tables, so we cannot use that type of constraint anymore. We can, however, apply a trick in order to get back to an order in between tables. Let's say that we fix one table, in this case it's table R, and now we only consider those intermediate results which appear on the path from table R to the root of the joint tree. And if I do that, then I can order the other tables besides R based on when they appear on that path. And I can exploit that by decomposing the plan space via constraints that refer to triples of tables, where the first part of the constraint fixes the table whose path we are considering, while the second part of the constraint fixes an ordering between two of the other tables. And now let us here in the example plan, by the way, would be in the left partition, since if I follow the path from R to the root, then table T appears after table U. And now let's reason about which subqueries we can eliminate based on such constraints. So,
sorry, this is not exhaustive. You can also have a plan where, like U and V, so in this path, U and V, they are not related.
Yes.
And therefore, T after U and T not after U.
So it is exhaustive, actually.
Exhaustive.
Yeah. It is exhaustive, but I'm not fixing constraints between any tables, yes. But I mean, this approach will give you the optimal query plan. It decomposes the plan space, but it covers each part of the plan space. All right. Now, first of all, due to the first part of the constraint, I have to focus my attention to queries that contain R, since I'm only considering intermediate results that appear on the path from R to the root of the joint tree. And due to the second part of the constraint, if T comes after U, then I cannot have T without U. And wherever those two conditions intersect, I can eliminate the corresponding subqueries. So whichever worker is treating the left plan space partition does not need to consider them. So each time that I double the degree of parallelism, I get rid of 1 out of 8 subqueries. However, I say that time complexity is actually multiplied by factor 21 divided by 27. And now I can imagine that you might be wondering how I come to that specific factor. Before, I have said that time complexity is proportional to the number of subqueries I consider. But in case of Bushy query plans, that's actually an oversimplification. Because for each subquery, when considering Bushy query plans, for each subquery, I need to consider all possibilities to split that subquery into two join operands, because each of those possibilities will lead to a different query plan. And in this example, I'm drawing all subqueries I'm considering for an example query joining 4 tables, and I'm also drawing in green all subquery splits that I would have to consider. And intuitively, you see that I have much more subquery splits than subquery. And also, when calculating the asymptotic growth rate, then the number of subquery splits grows faster than the number of subqueries. So if I want the time complexity, then I have to count the number of subquery splits considered by one of the workers. Now I can partition all subquery splits that are considered by the algorithm into 3 groups based on whether one specific table appears in the left operand, in a right joint operand or in none of them. And if I consider three tables, then I can partition all subquery splits into 3^3, makes 27 different groups based on whether specific tables appear in the left or in the right joint operand or not at all. And in this example, I have visualized those 27 cases. So each case that I visualize here actually correspond to a whole group of subquery splits that the algorithm might consider based on which other tables are present. And now we are going to see which of those subquery splits we can actually eliminate based on the example constraint at the bottom. Based on the first part of the constraint, first of all, since I'm following the path from R to the root, I have to restrict my attention to subquery splits whose join result contains R. And based on the second part of the constraint, I can eliminate 4 out of those 27 cases if I analyze the join result of those splits. However, when eliminating subquery splits, I should also pay attention to the join operands and not only to the join result. More precisely, I should again look at those join operands which contain table R. And if I analyze them, then again, based on the second part of the constraint, I can eliminate 2 more out of those 27 cases. And altogether, I have eliminated 6 out of 27 cases, which leads to the reduction factor that I have postulated before. Yes?
This seems like a back of the envelope calculation. Is it backed up by a more exact one? So if we go back one slide.
So this is an exact calculation, actually.
Well, the sizes of these red boxes, they are not equal. Some red boxes might be huge.
They are equal, because you basically, each of those red boxes represent a set of subquery splits, actually, which basically, you can basically imagine, like, here I'm referring to three tables, R, T, and U. And if I would consider all other tables in the query, then I could generate different instantiations of each of them based on whether or not they are present in the two join results. But I mean, it's exactly the same number of subquery splits. It's symmetrical.
I think it's a good argument, but still there is a wrinkle. For example, if you look at the bottom one,
yes,
that one only applies to cases when the left child has at least three tables. Where the right child has at least three tables.
But the right child has at least three tables.
Yes. But if you look at the top right one, that one only applies where the child has at least one table.
Actually,
so
not.
Applies to more than.
There is one. Actually, not. Because here I'm basically considering that I have made all decisions concerning those three tables already. So I only have left decisions based on the other tables. So this means that even if I have a smaller join operand, I will never consider anything that adds table T to this one, for instance. So this is actually, it doesn't change the fact that you have exactly the same number of subquery splits in each of them. What you say would be true if I would consider adding all possible tables to those join operands. Then this one actually would give me more possibilities. But since here I'm assuming that the decision for table T has already been taken, it means that I never will consider adding table T to that one. Yeah? So this is no back of the envelope. This is really a precise calculation.
OK, second criticism.
OK.
I take your argument. But this is for the easy case, when there is you must come after T comes after you.
Well, that is not an easy case. There will be a symmetric constraint with the other order. And if I use both constraints, I assume that one worker will treat the plan space with that constraint, and another worker will treat the plan space with the opposite constraint.
But the opposite constraint is not symmetric, because it's not a total order. When
I know.
Is,
This one basically, here I'm simplifying a little bit. So in case of left-deep query plans, I have a total ordering between tables. In case of bushy query plans, I can have multiple tables appearing at the same time on the path, right? This is, if you look at the paper, I'm also using a different notation because of that precisely. But it is kind of symmetrical, because I would say that one worker treats the case that T comes after or at U, and the other worker treats the case that U comes after or at T, basically.
So it's essentially the same kind of argument with maybe minor tweaks.
Well, I think the big. So I would say that the analysis is definitely more complex for a Bushy query plans. I mean, in particular, since for lefty query plans, I can focus on the number of subqueries, but here I need to analyze the number of subquery splits. And I mean, the main trick is basically that in order to decompose the plan space based on an ordering between tables, I first of all need to get back to an ordering between tables. And this is why we have this first part of the constraint. Yeah. So it uses a similar idea, but it significantly extends it in order to be able to apply it.
Quick question. So are you going to also tell us like how you find these paths or how you divide up the search things?
Yes, I can tell you something about that. I mean, we basically enumerate the different subquery splits that we need to consider, right? So I mean, there's, of course, the question of, OK, even if I have only to consider a certain number of subquery splits, can we efficiently exploit that in the algorithm? And with our algorithms, it is the case. So the time complexity of our algorithms is actually indeed proportional to the number of subquery splits they need to consider. So they can efficiently eliminate all cases which don't comply with the constraints without actually generating them. And I mean, the algorithm itself, it's, again, dynamic programming, just with additions to make sure that we never consider subqueries we don't have to consider, never consider subquery splits we don't have to consider. The implementation is also available online, actually, since recently.
There is an independence assumption here. When you raise 21 by 27 to the number of
right
constraints.
It's not an assumption, actually. I mean, I can be sure that there is independence. I mean, I'm the one who is dividing the plan space, right? And if I count the number of subqueries, then as we also prove in the paper, if I divide based on a new triple of tables, then again the same factor applies.
You have to choose a second triple of tables to be disjoint from the first triple.
Yes.
Got it.
Yes, very exactly. Also, in case of lefty query plans, I always choose pairs of tables that are disjoint. Yeah. All right. So based on those insights, I have analyzed the complexity of the yes.
So the enumeration of the query plans is done on the master node, right?
No.
No.
The master doesn't really do anything. Actually, the master just sends the input query to each of the workers together with an integer number that is decoded into those constraints that you see here. So the master just sends a query and an integer to each worker, and it gets back a query plan. Then it just has to compare the optimal query plan from each worker in order to see what is the global optimum. So it's a very low overhead approach for the master node. And this also is reflected by the complexity formulas that you see here, in which we have appearing the factors that we have discussed and justified before. And on a high level, those complexity formulas represent exactly what you want to happen, because the time complexity of the master is a very low order polynomial, and also the amount of network traffic is bounded by a low order polynomial in the input query size. So the only exponential complexity is on the worker nodes, but this is where we want it to be, because this is where it gets reduced via parallelization. And
one more question. So the,
yes?
The available parallelist that you have.
Yes.
It's a number of relations by three.
It's a number of relations by three. No, it has to be, so with the kernel approach, it should be a power of two. Because each time that I add a pair of constraints, I double the degree of parallelism. Yeah. So because like each constraint basically divides the plan space into two sub-partitions, and I assume that there's like one worker treating each of them. Yeah. OK. And yes?
So I'm interpreting those fractions correctly. Say we have two workers.
Yes.
So in the lefty case, there is one plan that will be computed only on the left, and one that will be computed only on the right. And then two or three others that would be computed by both in duplicate.
So no plan will be computed as a duplicate. But in order to calculate a plan, you have to calculate partial plans for different subqueries. And some of those subqueries will be treated by multiple workers. But if you look only at the completed plans, then the decomposition is actually perfect without overlap. So no two workers will treat the same completed plan.
I see. So the subplans will be duplicated.
Some of them.
Yes.
And actually, this also refers to the next point that I wanted to make here. We have discussed that there is a certain amount of redundancy left, and the question is whether we can do better than that. But in the paper, we showed that if you consider similar decomposition methods, which avoid, for instance, any communication between workers, then in order to cover the entire plan space, given those dependencies, this is actually the optimum reduction factors that you can get. I've also implemented that approach using Spark and tested scalability on a large cluster. And you see that here, optimization time decreases very smoothly. Some of those lines end a little bit earlier. We have discussed about the fact that we want to find table pairs and table triples that are disjoint. So the degree of parallelism that we can exploit for small queries is a bit limited. But for small queries, in many cases, you don't need to parallelize their optimization anyway. And this is the, let me maybe, oh, yes.
Maybe we'll finish this slide. I didn't have a question like the slide before. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, let me quickly finish this one off maybe. So here you see results for traditional query optimization, but I have justified before that we can actually use the same high-level approach for different problem variants. And here you see results for multi-objective query optimization, and we have exactly the same tendencies. And perhaps another important point, now those slides talk only about execution time, but another thing that people are scared of in query optimization, that is main memory consumption. And using this approach, we not only reduce execution time, but we actually also reduce the main memory consumption per worker. So it might allow you to optimize queries that you cannot even optimize on a single node due to limited main memory. And in principle, of course, you could use the same approach on a single node in order to decompose the optimization of a query which needs too much main memory into multiple optimization steps that fit into main memory. So let me maybe quickly finish, and then we can discuss. So I'm happy to discuss more about that. So this was my work on parallelization, where I basically show how to exploit hardware that we are using today for large-scale data analysis for query optimization. In the next approach, I'm basically trying out how we might be able to use hardware that we could use in the future for query optimization as well. And more precisely, I'm talking about quantum computing. Now, the high-level difference between a classical computer and a quantum computer is that a quantum computer operates on qubits, where the classical computer operates on bits. And the difference between qubits and bits is that qubits can be in multiple states at the same time that would be considered mutually exclusive according to the laws of classical physics, but they are allowed according to the laws of quantum mechanics. And with a highly simplifying intuition, quantum computers can exploit those superposition states in order to achieve a certain type of parallelization that is not possible on classical computers. Now, quantum computing has, of course, been a purely theoretical research area of computer science. Until very recently, a couple of companies have proposed a couple of first machines that realize a limited form of quantum computing, and they use very few qubits and suffer from various limitations, but still. The machine that I was using for this work is the one that you see in this picture here. It was paid for by Google. It was produced by the Canadian company D-Wave, and it's currently hosted at the NASA campus in California. And if you would open up that machine, then you would see a matrix of tiny metal loops, which represent qubits, and they are made of the metal niobium, which has the property that if you cool it down to a temperature of around 15 millikelvin, which is actually colder than in interstellar space, then it becomes superconducting, which means that power can flow in two directions at the same time. And since power flowing in one direction represents one, and power flowing into the other direction represents zero, this basically represents superposition. You also see that we have so-called couplings between pairs of qubits, which allows them to exchange information. And altogether, this hardware actually defines the types of problems that you can solve on the machine, because qubits can model binary variables, and those couplings can model products between variables. So in total, you can represent quadratic formulas that depend on binary variables. And the machine executes a process called quantum annealing in order to find the minimum cost values for those functions, which is an NP-hard optimization problem called quadratic unconstrained binary optimization. Now, this machine has been very controversially discussed over the past years. Here I have put some recent comments from famous people in the field that have commented on this machine. In particular, I've included Scott Arison, who is perhaps known to be the most critical person towards this hardware architecture. And the first question that was being discussed is whether this machine actually deserves the tag limited quantum computer. It's certainly not a universal quantum computer, but does quantum mechanics play a significant enough role in its computation in order to allow the tag quantum computer? And now, since recently the consensus seems to be that it actually does deserve the tag quantum computer, Scott Arison, for instance, has recently written on his blog that now current experimental results seems to justify the claim that quantum mechanics is used. So now the focus of the discussion seems to be shifting to whether or not this actually can be helpful and would be useful to complement classical computers in the long term. And one question that is raised by several of those people is, what is the performance benefit for practically relevant problems? Because for most practically relevant problems, in order to solve them on that machine, I first have to transform them into this restrictive input format that is supported by the machine. And this transformation easily leads to a blow up in the problem representation size, which is bad for performance. And the paper that I recently presented on VLDB, it connects to that discussion because we have looked at one classical database-related optimization problem, which is the problem of multiple query optimization, where you want to optimize the execution of a batch of queries by exploiting work overlap between query plans for different queries. And in the paper, we first of all show how to transform instances of that problem into quadratic formulas to minimize, and in a first step, we introduce binary variables that represent whether specific plans are executed or not, and we make a quadratic formula that depends on those binary variables and contains terms related to plan execution time, terms related to work overlap between different plans, and terms representing problem constraints, such as the constraint that each query in the batch needs to be executed. Now we are not done yet. In a second phase of the transformation, we still need to decide which specific group of qubits represents each of those variables. And this mapping needs to comply with various constraints because, first of all qubits representing the same variable need to be connected in the qubit matrix. And as you see, those connections over couplings, they are quite sparse. And also, if two variables appear in a product in the quadratic formula, their qubits have to be connected via at least one coupling. So finding such a mapping with the minimal number of qubits is in general an NP-hard problem, but we worked out efficient mappings specifically for the problem of multiple query optimization. And we used them in order to experimentally evaluate that machine against a commodity computer running all the typical algorithms used for multiple query optimization. And on the quantum computer, of course, we run our approach. Now, the interesting question is, can we actually win even against a commodity computer? Because the commodity computer has the advantage that it can work on the original problem representation, while in order to apply quantum annealing, we need the transformation. And it is already clear that there are problem instances that cannot be represented with the given number of qubits, which is just a little bit over 1,000. The interesting question is, are there also problem instances where the performance of the quantum media actually becomes interesting? And that is the focus of the experiments. Here you see a little extract from our experiments. We generated problem instances that we categorize according to how many qubits we need in order to represent a single problem variable. That you have on the x-axis, on the y-axis, you have the speed up compared to the best algorithm on the classical computer. And as you see here, as long as the number of qubits per variable are close to the theoretical optimum of 1, we can get some interesting speed-ups. But as soon as problems become harder to represent, this speed-up decreases quickly.
This includes the mapping time.
This does not include the mapping time. But you would also need a mapping on the classical computer, for instance, in order to apply a linear programming. You also report the mapping time in the paper. And even if you take the mapping time into account, because our approach is only, it has like quadratic complexity. So this is actually very fast. Yes?
So what are those concurrency evaluating
here? Right. So this is an artificial benchmark, basically. So we use the fixed random probability distribution in order to decide on query execution cost and cost overlap. So it's not a complete system. We are not targeting TPCH.
How many relations per query?
Well, actually, in multiple query optimization, you assume that query optimization is done in the first phase, and the output of that are multiple candidate plans for each of the queries, right? And then the question is to find the optimal combination of those candidate plans. This means that things like how many query tables we have and so on, they actually get abstracted away until we start with multiple query optimization. In the end, you just have alternative candidate plans with associated execution costs, and you have like links between those plans that symbolize cost overlap.
Oh, I see.
Right. And you can find more details in the corresponding paper on VLDB. And now I think that I'm running over the time, so should I finish here? All right. Good. Then otherwise, I would have talked a little bit about my Google project. But OK. So in summary, here I have presented some recent results in query optimization. It was about making query optimization faster, and in particular about making solving query optimization problem variants tractable that are motivated by the specific context of large-scale data analysis and that could not be efficiently solved with the methods that existed at the start of my dissertation. I've only discussed two of those approaches. You can find details about the other ones on my website. And now I look forward to your questions if you have more. Yes?
Could you compare the encoding you use on quantum computers to the mixed integer linear programming encoding that you had reported on in the past?
You mean the one on query optimization?
Yes.
So it is a completely different transformation. I would say the spirit is somewhat a similar one because we show how to transform a query optimization variant into something that can be solved on an existing solver. But the transformation is completely different because, first of all, the problem is a different one. In case of linear programming, it's about join ordering. Here, we are dealing with a different query optimization variant where it's about selecting a combination of a candidate plans. It's not about an ordering. And then also, the formalism is a different one, the target formalism, because in the one on integer linear programming, I have to deal with linear constraints. And here, I'm actually making quadratic formulas. And also, the constraints are a little bit different ones. If you use a linear integer programming solver, then introducing new variables, that's not so much of a problem. I mean, of course, you want to reduce the search space size. But let's say if you're using this quantum annealing machine and you have only about 1,000 qubits and not even all of them are connected, then you're really fighting for each single variable that you need to introduce. So the constraints and the motivations are a little bit different ones. Yes?
So we can go back to the slide summarizing the complexity result of that first word.
That's okay, it's okay. Yes, this one?
Yes. So I'm trying to understand, for example, if you have a single loop and you do a kind of similar dynamic programming approach, I mean, without this partitioning algorithm, which assuming that no computation is redundant, like how much like redundant computation you make here kind of by